First of all, we'd like to thank you all for coming to the Bethel Park Memorial Service at the cemetery. Hope you enjoyed the parade. I'd like to thank all of our participants for the fine job they did. We have a little special treat this year with the fire department coming up with the idea of putting the flag across the entrance from the two aerial trucks. It's a very nice touch. As usual, once again, I'd like to thank a group that hadn't been recognized for many years, the Coverdale VFW, the Color Guard, that raising the flow as a flag here for the ceremony. Has done it for many years, and nobody knew who they were, including me. Thanks, guys. On a sad note, if you look around the cemetery today, we do our deceased list from the American Legion. We lost one member, Leo Gilday, who for years was here before Memorial Day with the scouts and people putting all the flags on the veterans' graves. We just lost Leo this year, but we're going to miss him. The bunting you see around the podium here was kindly donated by the family of Margaret Garl, who was one of our charter members of the Legion we lost this year. The family donated that bunting in her name. We'll continue to put it up every year in memory of Margaret. Once we follow the ceremony here, we will retire to the community center for the luncheon and drinks and some entertainment over there. So when you leave here, the luncheon will start over at the community center no later than 12. And once again, I'd like to thank the Patriot Guard for their support showing up both this morning and for the line of flags behind me today. And now, ladies and gentlemen, if I can ask you to please rise, uncover for a moment of silence to those who have gone before us. Thank you. Now, please remain standing for the national anthem by the Bethel Park High School Band. Now, ladies and gentlemen, be seated. I'd like to introduce your master of ceremonies for today, Commander John Normile from the American Legion Post 760.
Good morning. What a beautiful day. Today we honor those men and women who gave their lives for us. I ask that you also remember their families who have and still are suffering. Please keep them in your prayers. This time I'd like to have the invocation by Becky Brady.
Good morning. Before we bow our heads in prayer, I just want to first read two short scriptures to you. One is in the Bible, it's Romans 12:9, and it says, "Hate what is evil, cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves." And the second scripture is Ephesians 6:10. It says, "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand." I just want to say we're here today to honor those who did everything that they could do. And when there was nothing more, they stood and they died for our freedom. And I want to just say a prayer, so please bow your heads. Heavenly Lord, we thank you that we can be here today in brotherly love to honor those men and those women who stood in our place. Those men and women who did what only they could do. Provide the ultimate sacrifice to ensure our way of life. God, we understand that it is through your provision that these good men and women were able to stare down fear, to look fear in the eye, and answer the call to duty. And Father, as we go throughout this day today in the ceremony, let our hearts be filled with the full magnitude and sacrifice that has been made for each of us on our collective behalf. We praise you for who you are. In Christ's name, amen.
And now I'd like to introduce the Keystone Young Marines for the POW MIA ceremony.
Ladies and gentlemen, please pause for a moment to recognize our POWs and MIAs. Please direct your attention to the small table and the Keystone Young Marines as they present the POW MIA table ceremony. Drape the cloth on the table. White cloth on the small table shows the frailty of one lone prisoner against his or her captors, and the purity of their intentions to answer our country's call. Place the rose in the vase. The single rose signifies the blood that was shed to ensure our freedom and reminds us of the many families and friends who keep the faith while waiting for their return. Tie the ribbon to the vase and place the plate on the table. The red ribbon represents the red ribbons worn on the lapels of the many veterans who demand a proper account of those who are not among us. The plate is empty. They cannot share a meal with us. Place the lemon on the plate. A slice of lemon reminds us of their bitter fate. sprinkle the salt onto the place. The salt reminds us of the countless fallen tears of the families as they await. The chair is empty. They are not here. The glass is inverted. They cannot toast with us. Place the candle on the table. The candle burns the light of hope which lives in our hearts to illuminate their way home, away from their captors to open arms of a forever grateful nation. The American flag. The American flag reminds us that the many men and women of armed forces may never return and have paid the supreme sacrifice to ensure our freedom. Let us remember and never forget their sacrifices. Salute. Ready? Two. This concludes the POW-MIA table ceremony.
Keystone Young Marines is a tremendous group, ladies and gentlemen. Please, let's give them another round of applause. This time, I would like to introduce the mayor of Bethel Park, Mr. Cliff Morton.
Good morning, everyone. Yes, that is a great group, is it not? Those young Marines, they come out every year and teach us about this, and it's just great. I want to welcome you all here this morning, of course, this beautiful day. We couldn't have asked for a nicer one, except those who might feel it's a little too warm. It may get a whole lot warmer before the day's over. I want to commend the American Legion for the years that they've spent in helping to put this parade together, and today, particular Commander John Normile and Adjutant George Tracy, and I'm sure they've spent many hours just doing this year's program, and they do it so well every year, and we're so proud of them, and I wanted to recognize them. Thank you, guys. And, of course, we have the tradition of our high school band every year, a couple of times a year, as a matter of fact, but for on this particular day, it's, in many cases, probably their last some of them, their last concert. They are very faithful as well, as is their leader, Chad Thompson, and we want to recognize them as well. So thank you, Van, for coming out. I was 8 years old when Japan attacked and bombed the Navy fleet in Pearl Harbor on a Sunday morning, December 7th, 1941. Our family had just eaten dinner, and had a tradition that after Sunday dinner, we would gather around the radio to hear the Edgar Berg and Charlie McCarthy show. My mother was fidgeting with the radio. It was always her job to find the right station, and of course the reception wasn't that great. She was fidgeting, and suddenly she stopped, and she listened intently to the newsman who was announcing the news of the bombing. It meant nothing to my 8-year-old mind, but I knew it was bad, because my mother was crying and saying, oh Lord, over and over. Our lives, as did every life in America, changed that night. For the next 4 years, Americans worked together, played together, and prayed together with a common goal to win this war. Losing was not an option. Finally, I was 12 years old, and the war ended. And as I reflect over those years at the time of my life, I'm grateful, really, for the lessons that we learned during that time. Lessons in responsibility, lessons in respect, lessons in remembrance, and lessons in reverence. While these lessons were reinforced by our school teachers, they were taught by the way most adults lived in their lives. I commend those young parents who are here today with children and encourage them to teach their children what it means to be an American, what it means to be responsible, what it means to show and have respect, what it means to have remembrance, and what it means to have reverence. I also commend those adults who attend here every year to pay their respects to our veterans and offer due remembrance to those who paid the ultimate price. I thank you all for attending. May all of you have a wonderful day. May God bless you, and may God always bless America. Thank you.
At this time, I'd like to introduce our district magistrate, Commander Rob Wyda.
Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Thank you for coming out. I don't have any prepared remarks, which is usually my style in gatherings of this nature, and I didn't set off that car horn. That was something unprepared. But if I could change the focus for just one quick minute to help each of you understand the significance of you being here. You know, I have been privileged to serve overseas 3 times, Afghanistan and Iraq and also Guantanamo Bay. And before a service member is sent overseas, one of the things we're told is that it's a privilege to go overseas and to serve. And when we come home, then you're patted on the back and said, thank you for doing your job. It kind of went from a privilege to a job, but that's how we tend to do things in the military. But when you come home and you've served and you're back with your family, because that separation from family, your loved ones, is just the hardest part of serving. While we here today commemorate and we honor the men and women who have served our country and our nation in the most noble and honorable and brave fashion, I cannot help but, when I march through and I see all of you and I see the people along the parade route, to think and also say, from those of us who have been there, who have served, who have been shot at, who have mortars aimed at us, God, we thank you so much that you at least honor us in this way. You cheer us, you cheer us on, you give us encouragement and support. Little things, letters and care packages and so many things. On a day like this, please let us not forget our family and our friends. That's the reason why we go. So on a day like this, if you see a mother or a father of a son or a daughter who has gone and paid the ultimate sacrifice, or who has been harmed for service to our country, thank them and also think of them. It is so very important and vital for all of us who have served to know that we are appreciated, that we are loved. Let us never again repeat the disgrace that many of our Vietnam veterans experienced when they came home and felt as if their service may not have been appreciated. Let us always honor the veteran, the veteran's family, their mothers, their fathers, their husbands, their wives, their sons, their daughters, and most of all, their orphans. That is the privilege of being here. That is the message I would wish to convey to you and say from the bottom of my heart, as a man who has left his family and gone overseas to serve, not once, not twice, but three times, thank you all for being here. I'll tell you one final thing. In 2007, Christmas morning, I woke up in my dingy little trailer in the middle of the desert in Iraq. And I had 6 more months to go there, and I thought, this has got to be one of the lowest moments of my life. And I actually thought about Memorial Day 2008 and being back here and seeing so many hundreds of you here. It is a memory, and your reality here means something. So while you have clapped today and cheered for all of us who wear the uniform, honest to God, it's appreciated so much. God bless you, every one of you, for being here. And God bless America. Thank you.
This time I'd like to introduce Mark O'Brien and Bob Daly.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed the faithful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea, with a glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us die to make men free, while God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on.
Thank you. Thank you.
This time I'm going to introduce Lieutenant Colonel Crawl, Daniel Crawl. Lieutenant Colonel Crawl is a native of Bethel Park, and his parents, Joe and Val, reside locally. Lieutenant Crawl graduated from the United States Naval Academy in 1983 and was commissioned in the United States Marine Corps. He attended flight school in Pensacola, Florida, and received his Wings of Gold in June 1985. Lieutenant Colonel Crawl completed his master's degree in aviation systems from the University of Tennessee in 1997. Following initial aircraft training in the CH-53E Super Stallion, Lieutenant Crawl was assigned to HMH 466, better known as the Wolfpack, with subsequent reassignment to HMM 166 composite for their maiden deployment to the Western Pacific with the 13th Marine Amphibious Unit in 1987. Another Westpac deployment followed in 1989 with the HMM-161 composite attached to the first ever Marine Expeditionary Unit Special Operations capable, the 13th MEU. In August of 1990, following the Iraqi invasion of Kuwait, Lieutenant Colonel Kral and HMH-466 were deployed to Saudi Arabia for Operation Desert Shield and Desert Storm as part of the 3rd Marine Aircraft Wing. Lieutenant Colonel Kral was transferred to HMT-302 as a flight instructor upon his return and was selected to attend the United States Naval Test Pilot School in Pax River, Maryland. After Naval Test Pilot School graduation in the summer of 1994, he participated in various flight test efforts, including the lead the fleet integration of a ground proximity warning system in the CH-53E and the design, development, and testing of display symbology for the newly integrated ANAVS-7 night vision goggle heads-up display in the CH-53E. Lieutenant Colonel Kral returned to HMH-466 with the 3rd Marine Aircraft Wing on the West Coast for deployment to the United States Central Command in anticipation of executing Operation Desert Thunder in the spring of 1998. The unit led Operation Safe Departure, the evacuation of the U.S. Embassy in Arita, Africa, due to recommencement of a war with Ethiopia. During May of 2000, he returned to the Pax River Naval Air Station with initial assignment to the Naval Rotary Wing Test Squadron to conduct lead flight testing in support of the C-130J aerial refueling system. The transfer to his final duty assignment took place in May of 2001 to the Heavy Lift Helicopter Program Office as the Integrated Program Lead. An assault helicopter and developmental pilot with over 3,000 hours, Lieutenant Colonel Kral has flown over 44 different type, model, and series aircraft. He is married to former Lisa Friend of St. Gabriel, California. They have 5 sons: Jack, Peter, Michael, Joseph, and David, and 1 princess, Daria. They reside in Maryland. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Lieutenant Colonel Dan Kral.
Well, hello, Bethel Park. Good morning on this blessed day, and thank you for our local American Legion, who invited me here today as the guest of honor for this 2012 Memorial Day celebration. You know, my wife gave me some advice. You know, wives aren't used to doing that, but she did offer me some advice and said, keep it interesting and short. Keep it interesting so your kids don't fall asleep, and keep it short so I don't fall asleep. I return as a son of this town, having spent my first year here as a young boy in first grade, going to Bethel Park Memorial Elementary School, just down the road here. I guess it's fitting that I return here on Memorial Day as an old man to close the loop. That was supposed to be a joke. I don't consider myself an old man. You know, 50 is the new 30, haven't you heard? Speaking of Bethel Park Memorial Elementary, that's the first recorded evidence of my desire to go in the military. While I was there, probably fourth or fifth grade, I checked out a book called The Annapolis Story. You know how library books were back then? They had a card in the sleeve, and when you checked it out, they stamped your name on the card. Well, sure enough, after graduating from Bethel Park High School in 1978, I went on to eventually graduate from the Naval Academy in 1983. As a young second lieutenant, and the United States Marine Corps. Well, it just so happened, 10 years later, my younger brother John was going to Bethel Memorial and checked out that same book. And when he checked it out from the librarian, his was the next name after mine. Needless to say, the book didn't get a lot of use, but the magic continued because my younger brother graduated from the Naval Academy in 1995 as an ensign in the Navy. and he also went on to become a naval aviator. Now, if someone in the audience has a child or grandchild going to Bethel Memorial, I'd recommend they grab that magic book tomorrow. You know, it's funny, and I'm sure the other retired military and veterans in the audience can relate to this. You know, no matter how long it's been since you've worn the uniform, if you put it on for a wedding or a funeral or a ceremony like today, it immediately transports you back in time. And you're that young guy charging over the hill or taking off from the aircraft carrier or digging that latrine. Okay, maybe you let go of that memory. But you get the point. You swell up with pride of the time you spent serving your country and wearing the uniform. And in some ways, you know that those were some of the hardest but proudest moments of your life. And you never forget it. And in most cases, your family never forgets it either. Since this is Memorial Day, and on this day we remember those that gave the ultimate sacrifice for our nation in war and in peace, I would like to talk about some of my memories of those I served with who gave the ultimate sacrifice. You heard my background earlier. I retired as a Marine pilot, flying all those different aircraft. And I had the privilege of not only flying a lot of unusual planes, from a blimp to going supersonic in an F-16 over the California desert. And for those older veterans in the audience, I also had the privilege of flying a 1930s era PBY and a 1940s B-25, as well as some unique aircraft like gyrocopters and gliders. So aviation was my dream, and I got to live it over my 23-year career as a Marine. You know, going back to my brother real quick, the Marines in the audience will appreciate this. When John was getting ready to do his service selection his senior year at the Naval Academy, he told me he was thinking of going into the Marine Corps. I told him, John, I said, you followed your big brother to the Academy, and that's awesome, but please don't follow me into the Marine Corps because your brother is a Marine. You have to go to the Marine Corps because you want to be a Marine, and there is no other way. I think back to that famous Marine recruiting poster. You know, the one with the drill instructor, he's got his finger in the recruit's chest. And he says, I never promised you a rose garden. Talk about a weird recruiting philosophy. We're going to make your life miserable. Join up. But this is our core. Anyway, my brother got the point and became a Navy P-3 pilot, which was perfect for his personality and nature. And that is the beauty of our armed services. Everyone who wants to serve has a place that fits who they are. Going back to those I knew who gave the ultimate sacrifice, the reason I brought up my aviation background is because I want to set the scene for the next two stories. Well over 90% of the fellow warriors I knew that gave the ultimate sacrifice did it during peacetime. That's the thing about aviation. It's dangerous 24/7. Peacetime or in wartime. That's just the nature of it. The first story was one that sticks with me to this day. It was my second deployment on a Marine Expeditionary Unit aboard the USS Bella Wood. More on the Bella Wood later. Anyway, we were off the coast of Korea in 1989, and we were participating in Team Spirit with the Korean forces. One of the CH-46 crews was doing a beach reconnaissance mission to check out landing sites where we could do landings later on in the exercise. Their aircraft had a mechanical problem, which caused the aircraft to come apart and crash. All aboard were lost. The crew consisted of Captain Larry Beeson, First Lieutenant Chris O'Connor, Corporal Mike Vinette, and Lance Corporal John Edwards. And the date was March 17, 1989. In our crew's book, we put the following quote from Scripture. There be of them that have left a name behind them, and some there be that have no memorial. Their bodies are buried in peace, but their name liveth forever, out of Ecclesiastes. What stuck out of my mind from that experience was when we had the burial at sea for First Lieutenant O'Connor. These older veterans in the audience that served in the Navy during World War II know that burials at sea were pretty routine, unfortunately. But for me, that made a pretty big impact when we launched his body into the sea. Here was a young Irishman who died on St. Patrick's Day. And I'm thinking, is that the luck of the Irish they talk about? Anyway, we did the burial at sea, and his dad was there. And he really wanted to talk to us guys, the guys who were the shipmates of his son. And I was really taken aback about his demeanor. He was really calm and kept putting us at ease, telling us his son died, doing what he wanted to do. And that gave him great comfort. That memory never left me, and a couple years later, when I found myself in the middle of Desert Storm 1, I think my mom will remember this, I wrote her a letter. I said, if something happens to me, please don't go on TV blaming our government for sending your son to war. Just say that he died doing what he wanted to do. And I know there are a lot of veterans in the audience that can relate to what I'm saying. The other story was about one of my roommates when I was stationed in California, Mark Holey. He was one of those great Americans, a Louisiana Cajun who everyone loved and respected. We were the same year group, and both of us just recently got selected for Lieutenant Colonel. So he was a senior guy who had lived through all the experiences I had. He was married with two small boys who adored their Cajun father, who taught him how to hunt and fish and all that good daddy stuff. At the time, he was overseas in Okinawa on deployment. He had 1 week left before they were coming home after 8 months. That night he talked to his wife and boys before he was going out on a night flight, and he told them how excited he was to be coming home, and he couldn't wait to see his wife and boys. He took off that night and never returned. Another warrior lost. The reason I brought up these two stories is, even though I went to war and fought for our country like a lot of other veterans that are here today, there are a lot of our warriors who never went to war, but they gave that ultimate sacrifice for their nation. With that said, let's talk about sacrifice for our nation. I told you I would talk about Bellawood later, so here it is. The French call it Bois de la Brigade, la Marine, or the Wood of the Marine Brigade. This is where the modern Marine Corps was born on June 6, 1918. The Marines lost more in this battle than they had in the entire history of the Corps. This is also where the Marines received the nickname Devil Dog from the Germans they fought against. The actual translation from the German word was, they fought like dogs from hell. So fitting for the Marine Corps, we still call each other Devil Dog. The other connection for me to Bellawood was my grandfather. He served in all the major battles in World War I with the U.S. Army. Again, I'm not that old, but I always thought it was cool to know my grandpa was born in 1899 and fought in World War I. To close, let me bring this back to those we were remembering here today. When we think about World War I and World War II, we remember those in particular who gave the ultimate sacrifice for our way of life and our freedoms here in America. A lot of Americans don't realize the number of our warriors that are buried overseas from those wars. The American Legion has always been in the forefront of remembering those that have paid the ultimate sacrifice. To put it into perspective, on Memorial Day overseas, the Americans that are there and the locals place flags on all the grave sites in the 21 cemeteries spread out over France, Belgium, England, Italy, Luxembourg, Holland, and Tunisia. In the Ains Marne Cemetery alone, with over 2,000 grave sites, they place flags on all of the grave sites in a couple of hours with all the volunteers that show up. There are still those in Europe that remember the sacrifice our men and women made for their freedom. And when the American military come to their towns for these memorial services, they come out of the woodwork to thank them with tears in their eyes, because they don't forget. I only pray our fellow countrymen never forget either. Today I would like to focus on our World War II veterans, because they won't be with us much longer, And I want to pay tribute to those that are still among us. In closing, I'll leave you with this, especially for our school children that are out there. It's the warriors who have died for this great nation, not the preacher who gave us freedom of religion. It's the warriors who have died, not the reporter who gave us the freedom of the press. It's the warrior who died, not the poet who has given us freedom of speech. It's the warriors who have died and not the campus organizer who gave us freedom to assemble. And it's the warriors who died, not the lawyer who has given us the right to a free trial. And finally, it's the warriors who have died and not the politician who gave us the right to vote. God bless you, and God bless the United States of America.
Thank you, Lieutenant Colonel. I'd like to direct your attention to the Bethel Park High School Marching Band. This time I'd like to introduce past commander William Babcock for the reading of General Logan's orders.
Here is your history lesson for the day. When I grew up, this day was called Decoration Day. and it was since has been changed to Memorial Day. In 1868, on the 30th day of May, by General Order 11, by John A. Logan, Commander-in-Chief, Adjutant General of the Grand Army of the Republic, set aside the day. The 30th day of May is designated for the purpose of strewing with flowers or otherwise decorating the graves of comrades who died in defense of their country during the late rebellion, and whose bodies now lie in almost every city, village, and hamlet churchyard in the land. In this observance, no formal ceremony is prescribed, but post and comrades will in their own way arrange such fitting services and testimonials of respect as circumstances may permit. It is the purpose of the Commander-in-Chief to inaugurate this observance with the hope it will be kept up from year to year while a survivor of the war remains to honor the memory of his departed comrades. He earnestly desires the public press to call attention to this order and lend its friendly aid in bringing to the notice of comrades in all parts of the country in time for simultaneous compliance therewith. Department commanders will use every effort to make this order effective. By command, John A. Logan, Commander-in-Chief, and N.P. Chipman, Attorney General. That is where this day came from, and it's been observed ever since 1868. Thank you.
And now a reading of the deceased members who died this past year from post 760. William Shandrick, I mention him now because last year we omitted him, so I'm mentioning him now. William J. Brought, Jack C. Brown, John F. Calman, Thomas A. Campbell, Frank R. Cox, Bud D. Dodson, Margaret Gall, my good friend Leo Gilday, Edward Kratz, Stephen Orr, Frank Shaw, Harry Tazza.
From Marine Corps League Detachment 726 this past year, we lost Joseph Loy. We lost Tom Salbataglia. And we lost Ed Stewart.
People often ask me, what's it like to be in the commander? Well, at Bethel Park, it's not too bad. You get yourself a good adjutant. When he does well, you get the credit. When something goes wrong, hey, you got him. Ladies and gentlemen, the adjutant, Bethel Memorial Post 760, George Tracy.
Thank you, Commander. He's kidding about that. Each year I try to find a reading to finish up the ceremony that's pretty meaningful. And I found one this year called Voice of the Fallen. I'd like to read it to you now. Far away, a voice is calling. Someone long ago who's fallen. I listen hard and hear it say, hear me on Memorial Day. Under the colors of a flag true, I fought a war and died for you. Oh, listen to me when I say, hear me on Memorial Day. You knew not me, I knew not you. The war I fought was just and true. I knew just what I had to do, the duty of a chosen few. Oh, listen, Mother, hear me, Dad. Don't be angry, don't be sad. War is dark, notorious, but the goal was glorious. Listen to me, hear me say, I died for freedom on that day. I did not die in vanity. I died for all humanity. And as I lay here dying, dying, I think I hear some voices crying. I think I hear my mom and dad. But no, these voices are not sad. I thought it sure my fate was sealed. I thought I felt the killing steel. I watched the battle from the ground. I only see, I hear no sound. Now things are clear, a perfect sense, the struggle of the innocents. Oh, if I'd known before the war, if it is the same side we fight for. I was only just a knave, but my heart was strong and brave. The duty of a chosen few, I did just what I had to do. Sometimes I'm your brother older. Sometimes I'm the unknown soldier. If I could only make you see, we are all one humanity. Through the silence, hear me say, remember on Memorial Day. Remember what this day is for. Remember me and stop all war. I'm looking for Don Weiss. There he is. Has Don come up and do God Bless the USA for us?
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
If tomorrow all the things were gone, I worked for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, Detroit down to Houston, and New York to L.A. Well, there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say that I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me, and I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me, and I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA.
Thank you.
At this time, I'd like to turn the ceremony over to our honor guard for the rifle salute and taps. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We'll have the benediction now by Miss Becky Brady.
We are one nation under God. So it is fitting that we pray. Please bow your heads. Father God, we thank you so much that we live in a country that is still free, free to assemble like this in an open forum, free to recognize the giftings and the sacrifice of so many who have gone before us, who have done their individual part so that we could collectively be the greatest nation on earth. Help us, Lord, to never forget our history, the history of what took place so that we could be here today. And Lord, never allow us to forget our responsibility to our legacy, to our children, to their children's children. May we recognize the responsibility that we have of teaching our legacy about Memorial Day and about the sacrifice that was made and about the responsibility and obligation we have as citizens of this great nation to never allow their sacrifice or their memory to be forgotten. Father, we ask your blessing upon this nation. We ask you, Lord, to continue to protect us, Lord, against evil. And we ask you, Lord, to continue to raise up solid warriors who will look fear in the eye and answer your call to duty. We praise you for who you are. In Jesus' name, amen.
Ben and Jim, before I close, I'd like to recognize Lindsay Hudson and Peter Hinkles from the band that did the taps for us. I think you did a great job. But that concludes our 2012 cemetery ceremony. Don't forget, there's a luncheon will be commencing right around noon at the community center. We hope you join us there. We thank you for attending today. We hope to see you next year for an even bigger and better parade and ceremony. Thank you, and God bless America.